Recording in progress.
Yes, squad, good morning and welcome to Monday's training. So I hope this will be another big influential training this morning. I actually got a lot of insights myself doing this one. And just a heads up, guys, of some little changes that I'm going to be making. I'm going to be making the training sessions now Mondays and Thursdays at 8:15 a.m. Not Monday, Wednesday, Friday, just Mondays and Thursdays. So it's going down to two sessions. I'll tell you why. Not because I'm lazy. I've started to feel some of the content's getting a little bit diluted and a little bit rushed. And I want to see who's actually going to watch this video. So if you're not live now, of which I've just screenshotted who's watching live, I want you to instantly comment on YouTube when I watch this. Lee, I watched this video. And I'm going to see how many people do it, because I can see, this is exactly why I do it on YouTube. I've got analytics on all the unlisted videos, and I can see numbers going down from 120 to 90 to 80 to, I'll tell you exactly how many people watched Friday so far, 27 people, which out of 112 is not a great strike rate. So that also says to me there's a little bit too much content. And for some motivational juice ups, shall we say, I'm just going to be hitting up some lives in the private Facebook group. And another heads up, I'm also going to be changing the password for Zoom tomorrow, because there's a few people slipping in who shouldn't be. So, on to today's challenge. We're going to look at how much work is actually being done. Because I've said this so often, most people don't have an information problem. They have an implementation problem. And I know there's a lot of this going on, and I also know because I do it myself. There's a lot of these videos being watched, and they're being found to be very inspirational, very motivational, and then you are clicking off of this link or clicking off of the replay, and you are going back to living your same life, doing the same things, repeating the same habits, having the same thoughts, and expecting a different outcome, which, as I believe Einstein said, is absolute insanity. So I'm really going to start working on trying to put some things in place to force you to take action, because essentially that's my role, to get you to take action towards making the changes in your life, be them mental or physical, to achieve the things that you want and empower you to live your best lives and get results. That doesn't happen by watching a video and then not implementing it. Secondly, I really want many of you to drill back down on this energy thing. I'm not talking about anyone specific here, but if I go into the planner, you know, this big book that we're supposed to complete every morning when we get up to set ourselves up for the day, which took years of experience, years of training, years of life experience and research. You know, we have the two questions in there in regards to our energy, mentally and physically. How do I feel mentally today? How do I feel physically? Now, over the last few months, few people have been coming on these lives virtually half asleep with their cameras on. So again, this is something that you need to assess. If you're just rolling out of bed now at 24 minutes past eight on a Monday morning with super low energy and just rolling into a live, then we're not doing what we should be doing in order to get ourselves in the best mental, physical shape in order to start the week strong and have the best experience of this week. And I have almost all, I would almost bet myself, my house, and have the same certainty that the same people were shit scrolling at 11 p.m. last night and posting into groups and generally just going to bed, distracted, no focus, no nothing whatsoever. So before I come on to what we're going to go, you know, get your energy right first. Come on these calls inspired, focused, ready to make notes and learn. You know, this is Monday fucking morning. We should be energy up here now. What do we want the week to look like? What do we want to achieve? When are we training? When are we tracking food and everything in between? And I'm going to come on to lots of things that I believe that have stopped happening. I had a lot of time to myself planning planning stuff in the Lake District this weekend, which I'll come on to. I'm going to do another little YouTube video just to go through everything that's happening for us guys with the experience on the 27th of April. So if you haven't yet got the right information, don't worry. Now, let's first of all, here's a great real world example. Okay, I'm going to go back to this. Genuinely, comment identity, either on replay on YouTube or on this video now if you're watching live. Who actually did the identity task on Friday? As I said, right? 43 people have watched that video. How many people have actioned what was in the video and created their new identity? Because again, these trainings, if you don't take the action and you don't do the work, they're completely pointless. You may as well just not watch them. All they're going to do is probably make you feel a little bit good and a little bit inspired for maybe half an hour before you click off, you go into work and you go back to doing the same old things that you've done every week and expecting a different outcome. Craig Knowles is the only person watching who has done it. So I'm going to recap this quickly before I go into it, right? So remember, we created four columns, right? Peter Jackson, Kerry Apps, Peter Jackson, Julie Hollingsworth, Jane Hudson, Deborah Peacock, Luke Birch, and Matthew Smith. Because you're all watching live, you're going to get extra special treatment, and I want you to do this personally. Craig, send me yours as well. Do the work, create your identity, and text it to me today. If not, why are you here? What are you doing? Okay? So remember, I'm going to recap this really fast because you can go back and watch Friday's training. Okay? The identities, we had four sections. We had attributes, right? Your attributes are your qualities. Here's a little recap. Pick ones that you connect to. Inspiring, compassionate, courageous, forgiving, positive, energetic, adventurous, loving, healthy, gritty, resilient, protective, hardworking, and knowledgeable. You should have a list that you create for yourself. Then outside of attributes, we have roles. Hero, dad, coach, teacher, leader, business owner, warrior, achiever, friend, mentor, protector, doorman, club owner, rugby player, athlete, carer, entrepreneur, runner, and student were mine. Then once we've created our list of attributes, we create our list of roles. Then we create our action phrases, which are your growth phrases, which are your self phrases. Leads by example, takes risks, embraces discomfort, uncertainty, and challenge. Does the work, follow your passion, focus driven, grateful, smile, da 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 da. Okay? And then write them down. So we have three columns now. Then we have our action phrase, which is our contribution to others, which is how we contribute to the world. We remember this, right? Life is a growth-centric experience. Inspires, educates, supports, listens, impacts, empowers, loves, motivates, ignites potential, empathizes. And also, people back me up on this because I said I was doing it. This energy is real right now from what I've done this morning. I've decided, and in fact, Pete, I don't think it's you I was talking about, it might be someone else, right? I'm really trying 100% to cut caffeine out. It was Sarah, sorry, I was talking about. Because I'm finding I'm like this, doing the snake. Okay? I'm high energy, then I'm crashing. I'm high energy, then I'm crashing. I want to be solid energy all the time. I've lowered my carbohydrate amounts, and that's a massive thing that I'm working on. So I can produce the same energy naturally, not because I've smashed 3.5 cans of Monster and had a caffeine tablet and had a coffee as well. So again, this task has done this to me this morning. This has created this state. It's put me in this place. So you've got your list of 10 in each column. Then we want to take three, right? Now, if you haven't done it, just do it. But get your energy right before you do it as well. Now, I wrote down loads. But this is what I took away from what Peter has taught me. We can't just do this and write this down and then maybe say it once or twice and go, okay, yeah, tick box, I've done that task that Lee did, brilliant. You know, like you may have done now in the comments, or you may have done, you might message it to me, you might have done it last week. You have to feel it. This is what we were talking about, the heart and the mind aligning. You can't just say, oh, I want to live a more positive life. I want to live a more positive driven life. Like, feel it in your heart. I'm trying to stop swearing. Feel it in your head, feel it in your heart. Get your head and your heart to align. I am a confident, courageous coach and dad who leads by example, embraces challenge, and inspires others to achieve their wildest dreams. Like, don't care if the neighbours are listening. Shout it. Let them feel inspired. Because this is the first step to you becoming your authentic self. This is your first step to freedom. But you have to say it loud. You have to say it with passion. You have to mean it. You have to say it every morning. You have to say it every night. Shout it. Convince me. Convince yourself. Anyone wants to leave me a voice note of them shouting it, I would absolutely love it, because me hearing you say that is going to make me feel great. But repeat it a million times. Don't worry about what people may think. Do it as a Facebook status. Tell the fucking world who you are. The reality is, most people will love it. And if they don't, so what? I wrote down loads more. I am a courageous, confident superhero who leads by example and inspires others. I'm an inspired leader who motivates and empowers others and impacts the world on a global scale. I'm a hardworking, protective father who leads by example, empowers and listens to his son. I am a resilient warrior who challenges, embraces challenges and will never give up until I have ignited the full potential in as many people as I can before I leave this earth. I'm an educated teacher who is grateful for the opportunity to help others invest in themselves and achieve what they once thought they never could. I'm an inspiring entrepreneur who takes risks and changes lives. Those are what I wrote down. Do I sound like I mean it? Do I sound like this has lifted my energy? Do I sound like my heart's in it and my head's in it, and now they're both in it, so I can buy in and I can start to believe this? That this is my new identity, because you have to believe it. There's no point you doing it because it's just a task if you don't believe it. Just like there's no point going to the gym just to say you've gone to the gym when all you really did was walk on a pissing treadmill for 25 minutes and convince the world that you had a good workout. Okay? Scream it. Feel it. Feel it in your heart. Read it when you get up. Read it when you go to bed. Read it every hour, remember it until this becomes your identity. And Peter used a great example, and it's like, this is crazy, right? Because we talked about your identity's not stuck, or it's stuck on with the builders are looking at me like I'm insane out there, by the way. They're just like, Jesus, what's he on? Has he been up all night? So it's like, it's your clothing, right? But it's not glued on. It's Velcroed on at best. So we've either had this identity of who we are created by others, or we've created it ourselves. I'm not good enough. I'm too old. I'm not clever enough. All this crap we tell ourselves. It's not true. But that's all it is. And when we do this, when you think of going back all those phrases about yourself, start to create it. I'm a hero. I'm worthy. I'm resilient. I'm loved. I'm confident. I'm driven. I'm motivated. I'm going to do the work. All of these things. I'm focused. I'm driven. Think about how you're going to start to feel, because how you feel is the first start to how you think. How you think is the first step towards creating the habits, to creating the outcomes that will lead to the experiences that will be your life. But imagine this. Imagine walking into Primark, and this isn't anything against Primark, by the way. I've shopped at Primark and bought lots of things from there. But you go into Primark, it's closing down, it's the very dregs of what's left, it's all a bit dirty, none of it's the right size, it's a mix mash, it's a total jumble sale of crap. And you pick out the best you can and you put it on. How are you going to feel? versus you've got an unlimited budget, and what we are doing, the beauty of this is it costs nothing. And you go into flannels and you get a perfectly tailored suit and you get perfectly fitted shoes, socks, underpants, belt, cufflinks, and everything in between, and everything fits you perfectly. Then you go walking into the interview or the meeting at work. How do you think you feel? You're in your scruffy, dirty clothes that you don't even like, that don't fit and haven't been washed for weeks, versus this brand new suit or dress that fits perfectly. And that is the same as your identity. These labels are your clothes, but you get to choose which ones you put on every single morning. Does that make sense? We get to choose and put them on, and they cost nothing. So it's not about, oh, I have to shop at Primark because I don't have any money. I can't afford to shop at Hugo Boss. This doesn't cost anything. You get to pick the best attributes every day. You get to create the best identity every day. So do it, mean it, repeat it. What I just did on this training there, I'm doing that every single morning and every single night in the mirror to myself. The neighbours most likely probably think I am a complete and utter Fruit Loop, but I'm used to that, so I don't mind. So that brings us on to working into today's training, which I think is going to also be a big one. I always say that, don't I? I can't wait to tell you guys about what's happening on the 27th with the lakes as well. Me and Pete were there Saturday night and all day there yesterday. It's not going to be a tough one. So it's only about 4 miles of hiking in totality. But some of what you are going to see is the most stunning scenery you'll ever have seen in the world. Absolutely unbelievable. So building in from what I've just said, I'm going to go back to the basics. Gratitude, magic moments, how you want your life to look, what's most important to you, who needs you to show up for them today and why, and everything in between. All the world-class questions that are in the planner. Again, be honest with yourself here. When was the last time you got up and wrote down 20 things you're grateful for before you did anything else? When was the last time you got up and wrote down 10 magic memories from the last 6 months so you could be proud of what you have done rather than focus on what you haven't done? When was the last time you added 5 new things to your gratitude list? When did you last revisit your goals? When did you last review your goals? When did you last create how you want your life to look? When did you last get up and write a morning statement and make sure that today, I actually just messaged a friend of mine on Instagram. And again, this is a language change that I used. I said to her, I didn't say have a great day today. I said create a day, great day today. Sit down and create the day of your dreams. And right now you have the opportunity to do that, to sit down and create the day of your dreams. Or you can ignore this and you can just roll into work, roll into your old habits, not track your food, not go to the gym, spend the whole day tired, angry, reactive, moaning, blaming, complaining and justifying, and then probably at the end of it, making it someone else's fault, everyone, either from someone in your life now, through to me, through to anyone else, for your parents, to anything that happened when you're born, as it being their fault as to why you did what you did today and why you are where you are. So we have the opportunity. Who has totally focused on what they want today? Who has written a complete list that goes through absolutely everything that needs to happen in order for today to be a successful day, and put it into order, and put it into urgency, and reminded themselves of who they are, reminded themselves of what they want and why, and reminding themselves of the actions that they need to take towards that to make that dream a reality? Because every single one of you has the opportunity to do that today. But we have to do the work. Okay? We have to get focused on what we want. The one of the best and worst things about the mind, okay? You cannot multitask with your mind. I don't care what anyone says. I would argue that all day long. You can't be thinking about one thing and thinking about another. This is why gratitude is the best way to deal with grief. If I get sad about my granddad not being here, I sit down and I remember the years that I'm grateful for that I had to spend time with him. I remember him watching me play rugby. I remember all the good things I'm grateful for. Do you know what? Some people will think about Logan. He on my side of the family, he's never going to have a granddad. So I could be sad that my granddad's gone, or I could be grateful and remember the magic moments of all the experiences that I had with him. Okay? I could be really sad that my mum died when I was 6 months old, or I could be really grateful that I ended up being brought up after a certain period by my nan and granddad, who were the best parents I ever could have wished for. I can't think those two things at once. You can't be happy and angry at the same time. You can't be grieving and grateful at the same time. You can't be afraid and courageous at the same time. This is the best thing about the mind, and why when we learn to focus it in our thoughts, that's when we become world class, because it cannot think two things at once. Make sense? We can't be focusing on what we want, where we want to go, and who we want to be, and the work we need to do it, and taking the action and doing the work, whilst also being a miserable, mardy shit talking about what they don't have and blaming, complaining and justifying and making it someone else's fault. We cannot do those two things at once. If you can, let me know. Let me know if you can be happy and sad at the same time. I don't think you can. So it comes down to this compass needle analogy. Like I did a really high level, borderline suicidal intervention therapy call last week with a guy, okay? And his needle was so far pointing north, which is sadness, depression, anger, anxiety, low self-worth, every single negative emotion in the world. I literally said to him, right, I don't want you to read it, because then you'll start changing it and wondering what my opinion's going to be in this. I said, I want you to get a piece of paper out now before the call, and I want you to write down everything that's in your head, how you're feeling. Brain dump the entire lot onto a piece of paper. Don't read it. Take a photo of it. Send it to me and put the piece of paper in the bin. And he did it. He literally I might as well have said, write me the most depressing list in the world. He was angry down to the level that someone else in a nearby town had opened a shop doing the same thing that his shop did, and that wasn't fair. That was what he was angry about, one of the things. Like, not focused on maybe I need to upscale my own marketing and spend a little bit time on my own business. No, I'll be angry about the fact someone in the next city has opened a shop, and I'll put all my thoughts and focus on that. That's how much his needle was pointing north. He couldn't speak, think, or do anything without it being negative and depressing. And that's the reality of where our mind will go sometimes. My mind goes there sometimes. But again, the same as the thoughts, the compass needle can only point. Think, the compass needle is the best example, right? Can it point north and south at the same time? No. It can only, can you walk forwards and backwards at the same time? No. And it's the same with thoughts. We can't be walking forwards and walking backwards. So as long as we're walking forwards, we're going to be all right. So this is what happens. And even if we can slightly think of different things, trust me, with an ADHD brain, I do understand this, because you can't think the same things. You can't think different things at the same times, but it can change roughly every 3.5 seconds, as some of you have noticed on these lives. So it can change and it can lead to us getting confused and overwhelmed and frustrated and not understanding, but it can only really focus in one place at the same time. So it's either pointing south, doom, gloom, worry, scarcity, stress, anxiety, skint, depression, overwhelmed, not good enough, not clever enough, not big enough, not tall enough, yada, 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 yada. We need to physically shift it pointing north with our thoughts. And so what's the opposite again of that list that he said? Craig, I'll bring you onto the gym. He has, what's the opposite? Abundance, happiness, fulfillment, passion, drive, energy, confidence, belief, motivation, loved, good enough. But we're only going to change the thoughts, to change the outcomes and experiences by doing the work. It's not just going to happen. This is why so many people watch, like they'll watch my mindset videos for like a week. I give loads away for free to people that are struggling. And they're like, I feel amazingly. And then they just stop doing it. We have to do the work relentlessly. But if you've developed this, like the negative identity habits are the glue that keeps you stuck to your current circumstances. I've said this before. And it all comes down to thoughts, as I've said before. See how these are just tying in over and over and over again. But again, it's like Peter said to me, you know, sometimes we need to hear the same things 50 times before it makes sense. So I'm going to keep reiterating it. But if you have developed the habit of playing the victim, and trust me, I was there for 20 years, so don't get all bum hurt and triggered if you think I'm calling you out as a victim, because it's not a nice word. The amount of people when I say you need to stop playing the victim, straight away they get angry and they want to fight me and they want to argue, and I'm like, ooh, woohoo, hit the spot there, did I, darling? Because if you weren't playing the victim, you wouldn't have got triggered and you wouldn't be angry. So well done for subconsciously admitting what you are. That's the point when they normally stop talking to me. But I'm not here to be their best friend. I'm here to give these people a wake-up call. People want to just tell me their story about how it's different for them. Like, go talk to one of your depressing mates, because that's what they're there for. You can all sit at the bottom of the pity party tree together, talk about how it's different for you, blame, complain and justify, to make yourself feel better about the action that you're not taking. So if we have developed this habit, and I developed this habit, so this is why I understand it, we have to take personal responsibility and start working every day on how do we shift from victim mode to achiever mode, from victim mode to survivor mode, from victim mode to warrior mode. People will very often say this all the time. I was a victim of child abuse. I've said that. I was a victim of a toxic relationship. I was a victim of a narcissistic ex. I was a victim of, put whatever thing you want to put after that. Do you know what I'm here to tell you? If you're watching this, cover your kids' ears. Bullshit. Because you're here. If you're a victim, you're dead, you're gone. You're a survivor of the circumstances that happened. You came through those circumstances. And what happened wasn't your fault. It wasn't about you. You make it about you by saying, I was a victim of. You weren't. You just went through a difficult circumstances that wasn't your fault and it was out of your control. And guess what? You survived it. Just like you won the one in however many hundreds of millions of race to be the sperm that got the egg that got you into this world. You were a born winner. You were a born survivor. Anything else is just crap that circumstances or other people very often, subconscious programming, have allowed you to believe. And there is no reason why you can't drop all those labels right now, right today, and become the person that you've always truly wanted to be. So why don't some people do this? Because they'd rather stay where they are because it's easier. it's easier to keep moaning about how you don't like tracking food on MyFitnessPal because it messes with your mind than to actually just do the work and track the fucking food. It's not difficult, bell end. And if that triggers you, again, good. Because if you are that person, you are putting zero effort into what you say you want to do. It's not difficult to get up half an hour earlier and go for a walk. The truth is, you'd rather stay in bed and then moan about being fat. Again, if that triggers you, good. If it's not true, it won't trigger you. So, we can keep hiding behind the fact, I am, this was me, guys. I am the way I am because my mum died. I am the way I am because my dad never loved me. I am the way I am because fucking X, Y, and Z. Bore off, Lee. Bore off. Nobody cares. Not interesting. You are the way you are because you're choosing to be that way, Lee, because it's easier than taking action. It's easier to keep getting leathered every weekend than it is to stop drinking, go to the gym, and find a career you actually love. So we can keep hiding behind the fact that we think it's not our fault. And it's not. But don't hide behind that. That's an epiphany, right? It's not your fault. But don't hide behind the fact it's not your fault. You still blame your parents for the way you are. Fucking grow up. You are the way you are because of the actions that you take. And you can be and do anything you want. You can have the life you want, the personality you want, the job you want, the body you want, the relationship you want, the career you want. You just need to drop the labels, drop the identity, and start to focus daily on what it is you want and the work you need to do it. But if you want change, if you want prosperity, if you want fulfillment, then that has to go. Because this knowledge, this awareness, this being triggered and going, okay, that's me, it's time to change, is the start of the journey towards freedom. Not blaming, complaining, and justifying is the start of the journey towards freedom. If you're sick and tired of being unhappy, if you're sick and tired of your career, if you're sick and tired of your relationship, if you're sick and tired, I've just lost all my notes, if you're sick and tired of your body, if you're sick and tired of the rain, if you're sick and tired of whatever it is you keep telling yourself that you're sick and tired of, then you're just going to get more and more and more and more of it. Every single day. Whatever you are moaning about, you are going to get more of. Every day. Because we're back to the pictures, right? We're back to the marathon story. Look at Lee. Lee got tired. Okay? Lee didn't enjoy the ultra. Lee got a little bit ill. Lee ended up having a couple of days off work. So Lee's mind found 300 reasons to moan about the marathon, moan about everything, moan about the weather, moan about Rother Valley. It was Rother Valley's fault at one point. I was blaming a location. It was everyone's fault. And I got more and more pictures of why I shouldn't do it and da 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 da. Change the pictures. Because whatever you're focusing on, you're going to get more of. So if you're focused on scarcity, you're going to get more scarcity. If you're focused on abundance, you're going to get more abundance. If you focus on happy, you're going to get more happy and attract happy people. If you're focused on sad, you're going to get more sad and attract sad people. It's so true, this, okay? And I'm going to tell you a real world, this is really personal example now. It's also quite fitting, looking out across the window to the grey sky and the torrential downpour that is currently flooding my back garden to the level that I now can't go out to the bins because it's flooded. I don't want to live in England. This has been my victim story for nearly 4 years. I don't want to live in England. I actually created this phrase and I actually do think it's really funny. If depression was a country, it would be England. Without a shadow of a doubt, I don't like the weather. I don't like the area I live in. I don't like a lot of the people. It's full of chavs, stabbing, crime, drugs, scarcity, low energy people. I really don't like living on a street where, again, this will trigger these people, and unless they've got extreme mental health problems, it's completely unacceptable. Where I walk into a shop and there's some fat fucking Karen at 11 o'clock in the morning in her slippers and her dressing gown going to the shop to buy basically fags and sugar. I don't want to be around that. I don't like it. I don't even find it funny. So again, my head spiraled this. I want to be around this environment. I want to be around energy. I want to be around achievers, go-getters, people who lift me up, people who I come away from a meeting, like when I come away from our team meetings, and I feel alive because I'm surrounded by amazing people. But here's the thing. I can't change that. So if I keep thinking about it, what am I going to get? More and more feelings of it. But here's the little twist that I think will help you guys move forward on a lot of things. So first of all, I need to create, where do I want to live? And then I need to start thinking about solutions. How do I start creating a plan to move where I want to live? How do I start developing where I want to live? How do I start writing a new story? And then, I can't do that because I love Logan and he's always going to live here. So back into victim mindset. Can't do what I want to do. How can I? This is what you need to figure out. How can I make this a reality? Well, it's not going to happen in the interim, but I do want to live in Spain. How can I make it a reality? How can I stop moaning about the circumstances and make it a reality? Well, when he's older, maybe I could spend half the year in Spain and I could spend half the year in England. Maybe that's not going to be a negative. And he can come over and visit me every weekend. That's going to be a positive. How cool is it to get a dad that's got a house in England and he's got a house in Spain? He goes over there now and again and we still get the same amount of time together. And we focus on the quality of the time, not the quantity of the time. And everyone's happy. See, just that straight away. Again, it's not going to happen yet. It's probably not going to happen for 5 years. But I'm starting to move towards a longer term solution based mindset rather than just moaning about England and the rain and the chabs and the stabbing and the crime and the everything else, because I'm just going to get more and more and more pictures of that until I do my own head in. So again, now I've gone to, right, what's the plan to do this? How can I make this a reality? How can I make this happen? Even if it's less than that, maybe it was getting to a stage where I spent a third of the year in Spain. Well, that's still better than nothing. And it's more solution focused than just moaning about a situation and pretending that I'm defenseless and I can't change it. Who do I need to speak to? What plans do I need to make? So this is what I want you to start saying out loud. And write these things down every morning. And again, do it, do the work, get the benefit. Don't do it, don't do the work, keep on blaming. That is on you. But I am responsible for my thinking and my actions. Say it out loud. Write it down every day. I am responsible for my thinkings and my actions. I choose my thoughts. I choose how I act. And I need to make my habitual thought process a positive, happy, focused one. But again, you need to continually work on this. This is when I go into a drift and I start moaning and blaming and complaining and overthinking and getting overwhelmed and stressing because I've stopped continually working on it. This is an everyday thing. This is a when you get out of bed thing. This is a before you go to bed and in between if you have time. But having an awareness of how you're thinking and knowing it needs to change is the first step to developing as a habit and moving forward. But it's tough and it takes time. Just like we don't go to the gym once and look like Arnold Schwarzenegger. We don't go for one run and all of a sudden we're Mo Farah. So we have to do it over time. Consistently, consistently. And just like the first time you go to the gym, you get sore, tired, and it's uncomfortable. If you're going deep on this mindset stuff and thinking about really what I'm talking about, what I'm moaning about, is it justified? And you start to do this work every hour of every day on changing your own thoughts, because thoughts become beliefs, beliefs lead to actions, and the actions will produce the outcomes and experiences of your life. We have to do the work. It has to be habitual. It has to be repeated. It has to be consistent. But going back, if you've forgotten, right? These are simple daily tasks. Morning mindset and planning your day. Practicing gratitude every morning before you do anything else and every night before you go to bed. They're not big things. Planning your day and practicing gratitude in the morning with a coffee is not a big thing. Doing the same before you go to bed, reviewing your day. Did you do what you said you would? Did it go well? What do you need to do more of? What do you need to do less of? And doing gratitude isn't a big thing. But this is another world-class question. My notes have gone all over the shot here. So again, talking about asking better questions. So in a crisis, when you're struggling, when life has become chaotic, you might even decide that disaster is a word you might describe it as. Who said that? Oh my God, this is a disaster. Said that a few times. Oh God, this is a nightmare. Ask yourself this question. What is great about this circumstance that I haven't yet noticed? That's my brand new affirmation for when I'm like, oh my God, the landlord's selling the house, this is a disaster. Oh my God, it's raining all day, this is a disaster. Oh my God, two clients have quit this week, this is a disaster. Stop. What's great about this situation that I haven't yet noticed? Well, those two clients were a fucking pain in the ass who didn't do the work, resented paying the money, always made it my fault and drained my energy on a daily basis. Great. I've now got rid of them and I've made space for two people who can come in and make me feel inspired, energetic, get results, tell loads of people, and everyone's a winner, baby. Again, the house situation, look around. It was a disaster, but what was great about it that I didn't notice at the time? I'm now in a nicer house that only costs a little bit more money, and when this is finished, it's going to be a proper home, and everything's brand new, and it's beautiful, and the shower's better, and the kitchen's better, and everything's better. So it was a blessing. But this is a skill set you need to continually work on forever. By the way, I struggled a bit last week. You know what that bleeping was on my computer? That was my computer telling me that my screen time was up by 32%. There you go, I just had a very real sign from the universe why I probably had a difficult week with mindset last week. Because I was spending far too much time flicking on Instagram, flicking on Facebook, and flicking on whatever else. It's just given me a very big insight into why last week was probably only 70%, because I spent 32% of it watching other people's lives. So this is a little bit controversial as well, but again, an event is just an event. Whether it's everything from a divorce to an injury to moving house to COVID and everything in between. Again, if you want to make the event the problem, this will trigger you. Good, you've just had a sign as to the changes you need to make. But it's not really good or bad. And again, I've done stuff like this on social media, and there's always one dickhead who wants to go, oh yeah, so like the Ian Huntley murders, that was good, was it? I'm like, no, but you're just being a little bit ridiculous. In general, an event is just an event. The same as when I say, you know, there aren't good or bad people, everyone's just trying their best, and there's always one idiot who'll go, oh, so murderers are trying their best, are they? So again, don't drift into that. That's another mindset thing of, oh, I can still pick out something to challenge the thing that I actually should be listening to with an open mind to move forward, because I'm still not ready to change. So I'll find a way to disagree with it and argue with it and find some confrontation. So it depends how we label it. And we're back at how we labeled ourselves as humans. I'm a powerful, driven, focused hero who inspires, impacts, and people changes lives. So again, we label the event. You could label a relationship ending or a divorce as an absolute disaster. Your life is over. You're heartbroken. It's finished. What's the point? Nobody's ever going to love you. You're too old. You're always, this is me. You're always going to be on your own. You're going to live in this house and you're going to die a single lonely man. And that is just the way it's going to be. Or you can choose the label that you put on the event and not being good or bad. I've created room to find love, passion, purpose, and fulfillment. I've now got space for the right person to come into my life that's going to inspire me and take me to a higher level and find that true thing that we all want of love and connection and purpose and fulfillment. Okay? I'm getting a new opportunity to try again. You know, again, it's the same event, different how we view it. But we'll let, just like ourselves, we'll label it based on our thoughts. And we create our interpretation of reality on what we make these events mean. But the best thing is, we are here to change it. Now, we have to speed up here a little bit. But everyone has their own way of looking at life, right? And I just want you again to be okay with that. I'm not going to have an... Like, someone may want then to come back and counter me about, you know, what's right in England, which would be a great way of them looking at it, and I'd be happy to listen. Because there are what's great in this situation that I've not realised. Well, I could now list a million reasons also why I'm grateful for England. Then waterfalls yesterday is one of them. So... again, it's how we think about it. But another thing that's very difficult and that we need to do is we all have our own way of looking at life, and we all waste too much energy trying to impose our way of our looking at life and our beliefs on other people and trying to get them to agree, trying to prove that we're right. This is right, I'm wrong. So again, this is a great example. Lads, ladies, everyone, I think you're all going to probably laugh at this and just think, God, this is life, isn't it? This is such a real world example. So we're going to discuss real world dating. So you're in the supermarket, you know, or you're in the nightclub, or you're in the bar, and this guy sees this hot girl, and there's that little bit of connection. Maybe you're in the sunbed shop, you know, you got this little bit of eye contact, like a little bit of excitement, and straight away the guy will very often think, oh God, what can I do to impress her? You might have a nice car and think, oh, I hope she sees my car when I drive off. Oh, I hope she notices what good shape I'm in. Oh, I hope she notices my confidence. Oh, I hope she notices my expensive watch when I pay. I hope she notices how healthy it is, what's in my thing. Basically straight into, you know, I've caught this person's eye. There's an element of chemistry. I've decided that I would like to pursue her. What can I do to impress her? What can I get her to notice me? Pete would probably say at 5'7", you should stand on like a beer crate or something, Lee. That's probably the best way to get her to notice you. But that's what we do, right? This is what people do on social media. This is why people post constant nudes and bum shots and ab shots and back fanny shots and everything else in between, right? Please notice me. Please love me. Please give me your attention. please tell me my body's great and everything in between, desperately trying to get noticed. Now, very often, the person that they're trying to get them to notice is the absolute opposite. And again, I think ladies, you will associate with this, that the female in that situation is actually thinking, oh my God, I haven't got my makeup on, my hair's all over the shot, I'm in really scruffy clothes, I haven't made any effort today, I look terrible, and everything in between. So you've got these two opposite spectrums, could be male or female on either side. But this is the reality of what the point of that story is. It's the same game. Both people are living in their own universe. And the reality is, one person is worried about how they look and what's not great, and the other person is trying to impress, thinking that, oh, she's going to notice me if I do this and she'll be impressed, when in fact, she's just stressing out about the fact that she hasn't done her makeup or hair. And this is what we end up thinking. We end up thinking we are the center of the universe and that everyone is judging us and that everyone is watching us. And the reality is they're not. It's a complete misconception. This is the same with you guys going to the gym and being worried about people are judging you, people are looking at you. They're not. Most people, the person that you're maybe trying to impress in the gym with your muscles and your work rate and your everything in between, the person that you're trying to impress, if there's been some form of connection, is probably more worried about how her hair looks, how out of breath she is, and how red her face is versus how great your muscles look. That's how this example is so real. Most people are too busy judging themselves to even think about judging you. That is so true. We're all overanalyzing ourselves, not the other people. And this is why you need to stop worrying, because the reality is 99% of them aren't judging you, they don't care about you, and they're too busy thinking about themselves. It's a complete misconception that then leads to this feeling of that we're not good enough, that we need to do more to get noticed, that we need to impress people. Why do we need to impress people? To get the love and attention, which is the basic human need, which will get us the significance and the love and connection that we truly desire to make us feel like we're good enough because we feel like we're not. And this is the honest truth to go through. This is a quote from Peter. Most people don't care enough about you to even give an opinion or even think about you because they are too worried thinking about themselves or thinking about what you're thinking about them. And that's the reality of where we live. So the action stage to get, this is three stages to go through this. This was on a podcast and it's amazing. So stage one is where most people stay stuck. And this guy on the podcast is talking about his granddad. So it's good that we can get it handled now, not wait until we're 60 years old to understand this. Because he said it was his granddad who taught him, and his granddad didn't realize until he was 60 years old. So we have stage one. Stage one is we are worried about what everyone thinks. On YouTube, on replay, or now if you're live, honestly, I'm going to start it off with a big worry. Comment worry on the replay on YouTube. I'll know whether you've watched this far. Love it. Accountability. Or if you're live here, I can see you see it. But, you know, do you worry about what other people think about you? Yes, I do. Probably, there's not honestly a day that probably goes past when I don't in some format worry about what other people think about me. I have to be honest. So stage one is we just live there. And that's where most people stay their entire life. This is why they don't ask the boy or girl out. This is why they don't go for the job. This is why they don't have the confrontational conversation. This is why they don't do any of the things that deep down they know they want to do, because they're worried about other people probably and almost certainly being mocked, judged or laughed at, or they're worried about failure and how that would make them feel, that would then lead to the result in being mocked, judged and laughed at. And then we go into this stage two. And you see a lot of people doing this on Instagram and Facebook. I don't give a fuck what anyone thinks about me. Well, I'm going to challenge that. Any person who says they don't care what anyone thinks about them cares what someone thinks about them. Because if they didn't care about what someone thought about them, they would be too busy living their own lives to be making statements about not making statements about what they don't care about. They just would be living life, not caring, not feeling the need to state it. This is what we need to do. This is why one of my favorite phrases I say, you know, when someone starts a sentence with me and they say, I'm going to be honest with you, Lee, and I'm like, stop, let me stop you there. Why did you feel the need to state that? What do you normally do? Do you normally lie to me? Because I don't need to state the fact that I'm being honest, but a lot of people do that. I'm going to be honest with you, and it's almost certainly followed by a half-truth. Because that's why they felt the need to say it. What I'm about to say isn't completely true, and I know this, so at the start of the sentence, I'm going to state the fact that I'm going to be honest with you. It doesn't happen, okay? So again, if we're in this period of I don't care what anyone thinks, and we start to state it, and then we might move into the phase where we actually really don't care what people think, which is great, not caring what people think. But then the final stage, and the stage to freedom, and the stage to living the life that you've always wanted to live, is getting to stage three as fast as possible. And stage three is realizing that nobody was ever thinking anything anyway. Because you are not the star of their movie. You are the star of their movie. The people that you were worried were thinking something, the people that you were stating the need that you didn't care what they think, you'll get to a stage when you realize that nobody was actually thinking anything apart from you inside your own head. So to wrap this up really quickly, Neil, I won't be long. So remember, authenticity is power and it should be effortless. How do I be more authentic? Stop being fake. It's that simple. You don't have to do anything to be authentic. You just have to be you and to be okay where you are. Okay? The other key to authenticity is not coming from a codependent state. Now, a codependent state is when you think you need to be a certain way to make somebody else happy. Or when you think somebody else needs to be a certain way in order to make you happy. And when you can hit this level of authenticity and not worry, that's when you'll have the freedom of mind. That's when you'll truly be able to move forward. And again, I'm not there yet. And I'll be very open admitting about that. I have periods when I feel really lonely. I have periods when I feel like I need someone. I have periods when I feel really lost. So I'm not there, but I'm working on it. And that's what we need to do. Because when we're just being ourselves, and we're not coming from this need of codependency, when we need other people to make us happy, or we need other people to get what we want, that's when we'll truly be free. That's when we'll experience true freedom. Because as I've said before, your needs will change. So if you're relying on somebody else to make you happy right now based on your needs, then when in 6 months your needs change, that person's no longer going to make you happy. And this is why people burn through relationships 4, 5, 6, 7 in a year. Okay? The next phase is know who you are. Go back to your identity. Go back to knowing who you are and doing the task at the start of this video. And don't be afraid to get into it and be proud of who you are. Talk about the amazing parts in yourself. Love yourself. Go to the love gym. Exercise the love muscle. And understand that you are completely good enough as you are. Every single piece of you. Not coming from a place of ego. There's a great thing on one of Paul's videos where he says, cover your kids' ears right now if you're about to, if your kids are listening. But the guy said to Paul, "Fucking hell, you love yourself a bit, don't you, mate?" And he says, "Yeah, I do. I really do." He says, "Maybe you should try it and you'd stop being such a cunt." But it's so true. It's so true. It's like, yeah, I love myself. I'm happy. And it's not coming from a place of ego. It's coming from a lack of insecurity. It's not coming from a place, not that I love myself. Look at my boobs. Look at my abs. Look at my house. Look at my car. Look at how much better I am than everybody else. That's love yourself coming from an ego. The other love yourself is I'm just happy with who I am and I'm comfortable and I'm going to showcase it. And it's not that I don't care what anyone thinks. I just realise that no one's interested and I'm too busy living my own life that I'm not even thinking about it. It's not from ego. It's not coming from a place of ego. It's coming from a lack of insecurity. But that's where your power is. Understanding that you are already the prize. Own yourself. Love yourself. Be yourself. You are already good enough. How attractive is that versus trying to be someone that you think people will like so you can get the love that you need? Trying to impress someone to get attention. Trying to impress someone to get significance. So these quick little tasks before we recap. So this was a big one as well. If every single one of your thoughts was verbalized, how would you modify them? If you were Jim Carrey in Liar Liar, if you haven't seen that film, it's hilarious, by the way. Absolutely hilarious. His son makes a wish that he can't tell a lie. So like everything he thinks comes out of his mouth. So if you were Jim Carrey in Liar Liar, how would you modify your thoughts? But what we're focusing on here is finding the meaning of who we are, not running around in circles trying to impress people. Because deep down, your ego has convinced you that they give a shit. They don't. Stop trying to micromanage their opinions of you. And this is the difference between being the lighthouse, not the tugboat. This is the difference between manipulation and intent. This is the difference between manipulation and influence. How to Influence People and Gain Friends by Dale Carnegie is an amazing book. Manipulation is an egocentric mindset for your own gains that takes advantage of for people to fulfill your needs. Influence is I'm focusing on building my own life and being who I am, not tearing down other people so I can feel significant and hoping that I inspire people in the process. So recaps of all these trainings, because this is the last one until we move on to the next section. Number one. The quality of your life is always in proportion to the amount of uncertainty that you can comfortably handle. When you realize there is no certainty, this will become a lot easier. Number two, put yourself in uncomfortable situations that you previously couldn't handle because of fear and uncertainty and embrace them. This could be anything from the skydive to asking a girl out to anything in between. Do something small that scares you. This is what we planned for the meetup in the lakes on the 27th of April. So you will have different levels from doing something that makes you feel uncomfortable. For one of you, it will just be showing up and meeting new people. The next level will be we found a concrete, very safe platform that actually goes over probably what is a 50, 60, 70 meter deep ravine through rocks into a river. Even Pete and I were like, our balls were twitching a little bit, just stood on it, but it's completely safe. Then you've got the next level of a small jump into the river with the jumps going up. So again, it's not about having big balls and doing the big things. It's about whatever the thing is that makes you feel comfortable. It might just be going to the gym today and actually doing some work and getting sweaty. Do it. And that is how you will grow. Number three, be aware of what is most meaningful in your life and how you want it to look. Go back to what it is you want to achieve and why. Okay? Do you want to settle for the relationship and the job that doesn't serve you because it's safe or because you're scared of being alone? Or do you want a career that you love and you're ready to chase love, passion, fulfillment and happiness no matter what the risks are? Because you understand when you do, you will attract better. Lonely people attract lonely people based on their needs. Okay? And if you love yourself, you can never be lonely because you're your own best friend. Because love will always be with you. So get yourself right and then you will attract the right person. So today it's time to say there is more to life than what I'm settling for. But also to understand it's not just going to land in my lap. I do believe in this be the energy that you want to attract. But also you do need to then go out and do the work. This is what the training was last week. Thoughts only give birth to things if we take action. Okay, you're not going to think the perfect thing into your life but just by sitting in this room and thinking. So we need to create it, but we make it a lot easier by being the person that we need to be. And remember, we are all here to grow. The strongest trees grow in the strongest storms. So stop avoiding the storm. Do life with positive intention. Do the things you've always wanted to do, because if not, you will always regret them. Life is precious. Mortality is imminent for every single one of us. And the only thing you will ever regret is the things you don't do, not the things you do do. So go out this week and smash it. Life is for living. Focus on what matters most. Focus on who matters most. Focus on your thoughts. Understand that now, not when it's too late. But the overall of all these parts of these trainings of the last 2 weeks, which are now complete, is understand all of these things now. Don't keep waiting until it's too late. But thinking and thinking is the route to all positive change. Controlling your thoughts from the second you get up to the second you go to bed. Like I said, we can't be afraid and courageous at the same time. We can't be happy and sad. We can't be focused and confused. But we have to work on it every day. Do the small work. Practice gratitude. Remember the things you have achieved and your magic moments. Do your identity statuses every morning and night. And before you start the day, get into this state where I am now. Get into peak state. Get into energy state. And most of all, I want every single one of you to work on this one thing. And that is remembering you are good enough, valuing who you are rather than looking for validation. Guys, I love you all. Have an amazing week. And I will see you on Thursday morning. I'm going to film another video about the event and I'm going to create a reel when I get a chance to show you everything from the weekend because it's phenomenal. Those of you who are coming, I can't wait to see you there. I love you all.